The following is a presentation of Major League Baseball Productions.
It's a clear, cool night in downtown Detroit. The Tigers and St. Louis Cardinals. The Tigers on a 7-game win streak come into this World Series with tremendous momentum.
The Cardinals have come into this series as the big underdog.
It's true. No one thought that a team with just 83 wins could win a World Series. But they forgot. Forgot what it means to be a St. Louis Cardinal. They forgot that they had the reigning MVP and Cy Young Award winner.
Chris Carpenter, 28 starts it took him to win 20 games last year.
They forgot.
They forgot that this team had the most wins in the National League since 2002. They forgot that they had reached the playoffs 6 of the last 7 years.
Never get tired of this.
No, you don't.
The Cardinals have fantastic momentum.
They forgot.
And it all started with that game in New York.
They forgot that even youngsters can shine on the October stage.
Yadier Molina.
They forget.
The Cardinals have stunned the crowd.
Yadier, Yadier, Yadier.
They certainly had forgotten St. Louis Cardinals tradition. For this franchise has won more World Series than any National League team.
The St. Louis Cardinals win the 7th and final game of the 1946 World Series.
Or that magical things can happen when you put on a Cardinals jersey.
The Cardinals getting Weaver on July 5th from the Angels.
They forgot.
Swing and a miss, he struck it out. Weaver in 8 innings has struck out 9 for the game.
They forgot that no manager in baseball today has more wins than Tony La Russa.
Tony La Russa, they brought him here to get him to a World Series.
They forgot.
That this team gets clutch hits from men big in both stature and heart.
David Eckstein delivers again.
Yeah!
Clutch RBI double.
They forgot that it doesn't matter what you did in the regular season once the playoffs begin. Because then, if you win 11 games, you win it all. They forgot, but we didn't.
Swing and a miss! The Cardinals are world champions for 2006!
Major League Baseball Productions presents...
What about now?
The 2006 World Series film. It was a moment that just may have saved their season, as the Cardinals' playoff hopes were teetering on the edge. And then...
Pujols drives it! Deep left field! It's a gunner! A gunner! A three-run homer!
Albert's eighth-inning go-ahead blast brought renewed hope to a team desperately fighting for its postseason life.
We just knew that if we found a way to get in the playoffs, we would have the opportunity to go out there and just try to play our game.
And by the skin of their teeth, they made it. But when you win just 83 games and lose 9 of your last 12, you don't get much respect.
The St. Louis Cardinals came rumbling, bumbling, stumbling down the stretch. They are 11 under since late July.
We've gone through some streaks that everybody thought we were down and out, and we get to a point at the end where everybody didn't think we were going to even make it here.
I think the obvious question is this, momentum coming into the postseason. The Cardinals do not have it.
For somebody to discount them, drastically wrong, because any ball club can win if they get hot at the right time.
The record may be 83 games, but the fact is we still won the division. So we don't listen to all that outside stuff. Inside, we know that we're a dangerous team.
Dangerous or wounded, you can't give a playoff team a second chance, especially their best player.
Can he get to it? Can he find it? Yes, he does, but drops it.
If you got a chance to retire this guy at a pop-up, I suggest you don't give him another chance.
Baseball is a game of execution. It's executing pitches. It's executing at-bats, executing defensively. You just look at who's making fewer mistakes, and that club is going to win a short series.
Pujols has done it again, and the Cardinals have struck first, 2-0.
Behind Pujols and their ace, Chris Carpenter, the Cardinals began to stabilize the ship in the division series.
What Chris is, he's a true number one. If you've got one, you got a chance. And then he has to pitch like a number one.
Swing and a miss! He
struck him out.
You saw the evolution, I think, of a team really coming together because the intensity every inning got better and better.
Now the bases are loaded, two down in the seventh inning. A swing and a ground ball right side. Belliard gets to it, throws from the outfield. Scooped by Pujols. Unbelievable play.
That play just gave me goosebumps. I basically came out of my seat in center field. That just lifted our team.
Too much Albert Pujols, too much Chris Carpenter, too much defense.
It just snapped into place. Everybody just became one right at the right time, and things started looking better and better each day after that.
A swing, and there's a hit to left field. Wilson is being waved around, and the Cardinals lead 1-0.
It certainly helped that the Cardinals' midseason addition, pitcher Jeff Weaver, pitched nothing like the guy who was given up on by the Angels.
Swing and a miss. He struck him out. Weaver strands two.
And that rookie Adam Wainwright, who had just recently stepped into the closer's role, was displaying the poise of a veteran.
Adam has given us that lift that if we can get him a lead, he's going to go out there and hold it and get us the win.
Fastball called strike three. Adam Wainwright has come through big here in San Diego, recording saves in each of the first two games.
We're all riding high right now. I mean, we knew we were a great team. We just weren't clicking, and now we're clicking, and it's the right time to do it.
After losing game three, the Cardinals came back in the potential clincher with a flourish.
Go ahead, run it first. Breaking ball down the right field line towards the corner. Fair ball. They're going to wave around Pujols. Here comes a throw from Garfield. The Cardinals have the lead.
We just did not let up. It was just this relentless attack that just kept coming no matter what the score was. The at-bats got better and better.
A squeeze play. It works perfectly. In the score is Spezio, and they lead it 6-2.
The Cardinals no longer looked like an 83-win team, but rather like the National League's best team over the past 5 years.
The right-hander's pitch. Breaking ball, shot towards first base. Pujols has it. He steps on the bag, and going to the league championship series will be the St. Louis Cardinals.
The Cardinals head to New York and beat the New York Mets on Wednesday night.
From Shea Stadium in New York, the Mets face the St. Louis Cardinals in Game 1 of the 2006 National League Championship Series.
It was the Mets who were the National League's best team in 2006, and early on, they showed why.
That is a bomb to right. Mets up, 2-0.
We went in there knowing that the expectations were that we were not going to succeed, but our guys were bound and determined that they were going to play hard and make it a series.
And La Russa felt that game two was a good time to shake things up by playing one Scott over another.
Rolling on the bench, his spot taken by Spezio, and Scott bats with two on and two out.
Spezio's breakout postseason performance as an Angel in 2002 certainly played a role in Tony's decision.
Question about whether I should play him, whether he shouldn't play, and well, he's a proven pressure player, and he competed.
Back is great in the corner, and this ball is played off the wall. Two runs are going to score, and it's a 6-6 game.
That in itself was a statement that any guy on this roster at any time can come up big for us.
That was something Billy Wagner discovered in the ninth, when So Taguchi came up in a tie game.
Before I went to at-bat, Tony said, just get on top.
Bringing a long one into left. Did he get enough? Get up, baby, get up.
When I hit the ball, I recognized it's home run.
Home run, So Taguchi.
But I didn't know what happened.
One of the most unlikely Cardinals has delivered the biggest hit of this ball game.
You give him a clutch at bat, and he will give you a real good effort.
The Redbirds win this one 9-6.
I mean, it's a heck of a win, a very, very tough win, a very important win. It gives us a chance in the series.
Game three was in the hands of pitcher Jeff Suppan, who would join the Cardinals' legion of clutch players in the playoffs.
Jeff Suppan has been in control from the beginning.
I don't recall a lot from that game, and I notice when I'm not recalling a lot, that means I'm in the moment, and I'm really focused on each pitch.
A standing ovation here at Busch Stadium for Jeff Suppan. 8 shutout innings for the right-hander.
He play that one game you're in right now, and you're playing to win a series.
And the Cardinals win game 3, 5-0.
You never stop because anything can happen.
The Mets have evened up the series at 2 wins apiece as they crush the Cardinals 12-5.
Tom Glavin and Jeff Weaver in game 5.
In this most crucial of games, Weaver would be put to the test once again, and he passed with flying colors.
A pump of the fist for Jeff Weaver. A standing ovation here at Busch.
When I see him now, I see confidence in what he has. I see that he believes in what he does out there is enough.
And the Cardinals' bullpen continued its postseason domination.
The St. Louis Cardinals are 1 win away from going to the World Series.
We've been playing great so far this postseason. Hopefully we can continue to do that for one more game and hopefully win.
They didn't win game 6, so Supon was called on for the clincher. But then the Cardinals' magic was seemingly snatched right out of the New York night.
Just swinging a fly ball to left field. Going back is Andy Chavez. He jumped at the fence and he caught it. He brought back a home run. The relay to first base and they double off the runner.
Plays like that can be momentum changers, and it certainly looked that way in the bottom of the 6th when Supon faced a bases-loaded situation with one out and the game tied at 1.
I mean, you talk about a test. Well, then you see Sup, and you go, holy smokes, look at this guy dealing.
The 1-2 pitch and a curveball swung on and missed. Supon gets Valentin for the second out, and here comes the man of the moment, Andy Chavez.
After making such a tremendous play, I mean, probably one of the best catches I've ever seen, I felt he had a lot of energy, so I want to see what he's going to do. So I had two choices, I felt. I had up above his hands, and I had down off the plate. And I guess it was in the right spot to where it was good enough for him to swing at, and he popped it up.
Edmonds is there, makes the catch, and Jeff Supon works out of big-time trouble in the bottom of the 6th inning.
It was huge. But still, just one victory in a battle far from over.
If you're playing on the road in a tight game, the odds are against you. If they score, probably game's over. So yeah, now you're going to the 9th.
La Russa had played his trump card when he moved his suddenly red-hot catcher up to 7th in the batting order.
Yadier Molina hit only .216.
Bob.
He hits it in the air to left field. Back is Chavez. At the wall, this ball is gone. And St. Louis takes a 3-1 ninth inning game 7 lead.
It went from deafening noise, where you just couldn't hear anything, to just like a quiet gasp in the stadium.
Woo! You think, son of a gun, we're 3 outs away from winning this thing.
But what a Hollywood ending for the rookie Wainwright. Threatened with the bases loaded, and the most formidable foe the Cardinals had faced in the past 3 years.
The bases are loaded with 2 outs for Beltran.
Carlos Beltran, who's hit 20 home runs against us in 10 at-bats.
Beltran has murdered Cardinal pitching over the last 2 postseasons.
It doesn't get better than that.
When you watch a game 7, your little kid go out in the backyard the next day and you're replaying it. Adam Wainwright pitching, bottom of the 9th, 2 outs. You know, you never think Carlos Beltran's up to bat. You're hoping it's somebody that's not quite that good.
Beltran could tie it with a hit, win it for the Mets, and send New York to the World Series with an extra base hit.
Yadier came out to the mound and said, all right, what are you thinking here? And I said, hey, what are you thinking here? And he said, all right, let's go fastball down and away. I said, all right, you know, we'll try that one time. And then when he got back to home plate, I think he had second thoughts. You know, he didn't want a chance leaving a fastball up and out. Carlos Beltran, I mean, it's so deadly. So he goes like this. He goes, follow me. So I said, all right, we'll go with you. And then he put down changeup, and I was thinking, man, that's a great plan.
Strike one.
Had him 0-1, tried to throw a strike curve, and he swung at it and missed.
And now the Mets down to their last strike.
I said, I'm going to just throw the nastiest curveball I've ever thrown, and if he hits it, I'll tip my hat, but if not, we're going the series.
Struck him out, and the Cardinals have won the pennant.
Holy sh...
The St. Louis Cardinals have pulled off the upset.
And so the Cardinals were off to face a Detroit team that had ridden its first winning season in 13 years to the Fall Classic. Thanks in great part to one man,
The only man alive that I think could have taken the Detroit Tigers from where they were to the playoffs, the great friend Jim Leland.
There's outs and then there's productive outs.
Okay,
Jim over. And that's where we're
going to
play.
Leland came in spring training and said, hey, I'd like to play 9 innings and I like to play 9 innings hard. I'm going to put together the toughest 25 players on the team and we're going to go out there and bust our behinds.
I don't want you to just catch and hold. I want you to catch and fake.
The start of the season, we kind of took on this aura of, all right, you don't believe us, but watch us play.
Straight wins for the Tigers.
80 games into the season are 30 games over the 500 mark.
But the Tigers went into a tailspin down the stretch. And on the last day of the regular season, the division title slipped away.
And so the Tigers will enter the playoffs as the wild card, and they will head to Yankee Stadium,
where the Tigers also lost game one. But they battled from behind to win game two. And when the series moved to Detroit, the task of taming the vaunted New York lineup fell on a veteran pitcher who hadn't beaten the Yankees in 13 years.
Every hitter that came up to that plate, I was not going to be intimidated. I was going to be out there competing as hard as I possibly could.
Swing and a miss, got him again!
What he did for 7-plus innings was just incredible.
Was this happening? Were the Tigers going to beat one of the best lineups ever? Yes. Having manhandled New York, the Tigers went into the league championship series with the same confidence they had for most of the year, and the Oakland A's bore the brunt as Detroit won the pennant in dramatic fashion.
Three-run walk-off home run! The Tigers have beaten the A's!
To see his swing and to see the ball come off his bat, I knew right then that we gave ourselves a chance to go to the World Series.
The Detroit Tigers are American League champions.
Of course, this would not be the first time the Tigers and Cardinals had met in the World Series. Back in 1934, Detroit faced one of baseball's most colorful teams.
The St. Louis Giant Killers, last-minute winners of the National League pennant.
Are those Cardinals cocky here today?
It goes back to the Gas House Gang with that crazy bunch, Pepper Martin and the great Hall of Famer Medwick and the great Dean brothers.
Brother Jerome, better known as Dizzy. This is my brother Paul Dean, better known as Daffy. We're both full of ambition against those Tigers.
Paul and Dizzy got the Cardinals' first three wins, and Ducky Medwick helped put Diz in position to finish off Game 7.
Here's the pitch. A dive down to second, Mr. Rocha takes. Boss at the break for the final out of the 1934 World Series. A shutout for the great Dizzy team.
The two teams met again 34 years after 34, and this time just one St. Louis pitcher was the story. Bob Gibson had a microscopic 1.12 ERA that season. And in Game 1, Gibson made history.
He's got him! Strike him out! A new world record of 17 strikeouts in one game.
St. Louis forged a 3-1 lead, but Detroit fought back. And in Game 7, they called on the seemingly overmatched Mickey Lolich to face Gibson.
The pictures were of, God, I hope we can do this, but it's Bob Gibson.
Gibby and Lolich kept the game scoreless through 6, but Gold Glove outfielder Curt Flood made a rare mistake in the 7th.
A line drive is hit into left center, and Curt lost his balance a bit. The ball went by him.
We made a couple of mistakes here or there, and the teams that make the fewest amount of mistakes when you get in a series like that, usually the team that wins.
And this time, that team was the Tigers.
Everybody on our ball club absolutely went crazy. It was a great time for us to become world champions, and it was a great time for the city of Detroit.
I thought that we had a better ball team than the Tigers, but then a lot of times the best team doesn't win.
Did Bob know something about the 2006 World Series? For 38 years later, it was the Cardinals who were decided underdogs to a well-rested Tigers team.
Let's hope the 2006 series is as memorable and as competitive as the 1968 series was.
Prior to Game 1, baseball chatter filled the airwaves in Detroit. And much of it focused on the fact that the Tigers had not played in a week.
Baseball's not like football where you can take a week off, the injuries heal. Baseball is about timing. It's about rhythm. In my opinion, the Tigers should have lost some rhythm sitting around for 7 days.
You look at St. Louis, and they are battle-tested and battle-scary.
The Cardinals have been playing every day. They're used to this right now. They're already in this mode.
Jim Leland says anybody who says the Tigers are favorites is foolish.
Well, the big thing is that they had this week off, and it's really going to be hard for them to kickstart those engines again.
And while the Motor City revved itself up for its first World Series in 22 years, the Cardinals came into town on a roll, and there was no doubt that they were loose.
I said, watch out. There's going to be some banana peels in the clubhouse. I want to play today.
What do you think about the World Series? You know, ho-hum.
Dude, you bet it. You've done it, bro. It's pretty awesome, huh?
It's a lot of fun, yeah.
Hey, Joy, congrats, dude.
I'm just thrilled to be here, buddy.
It's been great having you with us.
It's electric, isn't it?
So you got any, like, words of wisdom that you can pass on to the people?
Hey, buddy, how you doing?
The only thing I can say, he's awesome. You got to enjoy it every single in, every single moment.
Everything all right?
Okay.
Thank you, man. Hey, you have to be okay. You're in the World Series, man.
And although this was the 102nd Fall Classic, the series was still marked by an historic first in Game 1.
Now, here's the interesting part. Because the NLCS went a full seven games, it's Anthony Reyes making the start, the rookie, and this is the first time in World Series history that two rookies will hook up in game number one.
You never know what's going to happen, especially with a young pitcher like that. If you're going to get nervous, you're going to get nervous in that game. And with the limited amount of experience that Anthony has had in the big leagues, I thought he would really be nervous.
When I walked out the first time, it just, I tried to put my head down and not look at anything else, and, you know, I was fine.
He may not have been nervous, but Reyes did have the fewest regular season wins of any Game 1 starter ever, 5, and he experienced some early trouble.
It's an RBI double for Carlos Guillen, and the Tigers strike first. A 1-0 lead here in the bottom of the first inning.
So the Tigers' bats weren't rusty. The next test would be their arms.
Justin Verlander and his belly's got to be bouncing. He's got to be a little nervous out there tonight, making a World Series start in game one.
You know, game one of the World Series, it's something you dream about as a kid, that I personally dreamt about as a kid.
And now here he was. But Justin ran into trouble in the second when he faced a resurgent Scott Rolen.
And it is long gone. And that'll tie the game. A home run by Rolen ties it. St. Louis 1, Detroit 1.
It was Rolen's first ever World Series home run. Gone was his over 15 World Series drought.
It was a real good at-bat, a high fastball in, and he turned on it. And he's one of the leaders on our team, and when he gets going, I think a lot of guys on the team follows.
And that they did. For in the third inning, with Yadier Molina on second, the rookie Chris Duncan got the chance to shine in front of his dad.
Well, I've gone through a lot of different emotions during this season with him coming up. Even now, you know, when he comes up in significant situations, you know, I'm on the edge of my chair a little bit, rooting for him.
Here's a shot fair inside the first base bag down the right field line. The ball kicks away from Ordonez. Molina scores the go-ahead run on a double by Duncan.
It's a tremendous feeling for me of pride in him, because I know how hard he's worked to get here. He spent some years in the minor leagues.
Yeah, it's surreal, you know, to think about being in AAA at the beginning of the year and just hoping to get a chance to come up. And then next thing you know, you're in the World Series. It's hard to believe sometimes.
But St. Louis was far from through. For up came Albert Pujols. And the Tigers were faced with a decision. Do they pitch to the reigning NL MVP?
You know, obviously, I haven't been getting that many opportunities with man on second and first base open.
There's a runner on second. We got Jim Edmonds hitting and Scott Rolen behind him. And Leland knows the ability of those two guys.
At that time, I didn't think about that they were going to walk me.
But I have a pretty good idea what Leland's approach was there.
We were going to challenge him, but we didn't want to give him something too good to hit.
To really keep the ball out of the strike zone.
You know, you got first base open. I'm trying to do similar to what I did his first at bat.
He just made me look really stupid my first at bat with a good pitch.
Swing and a miss. He got him hammer the breaking ball. Pujols strikes out.
So just made sure to put a good swing, and that was really focused and concentrating on trying to stay inside the ball.
And now an opportunity, if Pujols is pitched to, for him to drive in a run.
And I just put the best swing of the night, and I hit the ball out of the park.
Here's a swing and a high fly ball. Deep right center field. Ordonez to the track, to the wall. It's a gunner. A home run. Albert Pujols hits a two-run shot. His first World Series home run.
You know, one of the realities of this job, you make a decision. If it works, well, that's good. If it doesn't work, yeah, what were you thinking?
You know, it just goes to show how good of a hitter he is. You make a mistake, and then he hits it for a home run opposite field. So, you know, that's just one of the situations where you got to tip your cap.
The Tigers pitch to the MVP, and he makes Detroit pay. It's 4-1 St. Louis here in the third inning.
With a three-run cushion, the rookie Reyes was now making all the necessary adjustments to pitch the game of his life.
He stopped throwing the changeup so much, and that's when he started being effective because they kept looking for the off-speed pitches and he wasn't throwing it.
Ties up Casey with the fastball.
So he was just throwing strikes right out of the get-go. First pitch right down the middle fastball, and we were missing it. Then once he got ahead of us, he went to that changeup.
The pitch, changeup, struck him out swinging.
It's a pretty nice pitch. I mean, it's filthy.
But I think the thing that made him most effective was that he was getting strike one on the hitters.
Just trying to get that first strike and keep throwing strikes, and just try not to throw the ball right down the middle or anything up.
Outside corner called strike three, and Guillen knew it.
It's frustrating. You know, you start trying to find ways to get on base, and you know, you start to maybe try a little harder and try to get guys on. That definitely doesn't work.
There's a fastball swung on and foul tip. That's strike three.
You know, really just shut us down.
What impressed me the most was that he was able to go out and stay focused and stay relaxed. And as a young kid that doesn't have very many starts in the big leagues, to do that in such a huge stage was amazing.
If he's on, you know, there's not much we can do about it. You know, he pitched better than I did.
Swing and a miss, struck him out. He set down 13 consecutive Tigers. And as we go to the sixth, the Redbirds lead Detroit 4-1.
Reyes was overshadowing the Rookie of the Year candidate, who this time walked Pujols, only to create more problems.
Pujols, the runner at first, and a throw to first is a wild throw. It goes to the tarp and rolls down the right field line.
Albert Pujols is going to end up on third base.
It'll be an error on the pitcher, E1, and now the Cardinals have a man at third base. No one out, and a great chance for the Cardinals to add to their 4-1 lead. Swing, a base hit to right field. In comes Albert. It's 5-1 Cardinals.
A walk, an error, and a run on a base hit by Edmonds.
Edmonds and Rowland had been a combined 1-for-30 in the 2004 World Series. Now they were redeeming themselves and providing solid protection for Pujols.
It's a ground rule double.
And Scott Rowland has himself a double to go along with that home run back in the second.
Runners at second and third, and nobody out. And the Cardinals now threatening to blow this game wide open.
We will have our first pitching change.
Verlander was done for the night. The Cardinals had the Tigers by the tail as every bounce was going their way.
My mindset was definitely knock the ball down, get a play at home any way you can.
2-2 pitch, swinging a ground ball to third.
The ball was hit to me, and it was one of those in-between hops where no infielder really likes. So I throw my glove in front of it, and when I did that, it hit me in the worst possible place. It hit me right on the heel of the glove. Well, the hop came up a little higher than anticipated.
Brandon Inge bobbles it.
And I know at this point I can see my peripheral vision. Edmonds is taking off for the plate.
They're breaking for the plate.
When I try to pick it up, I don't get a very good grip. Make a bad throw.
And throws home, and he throws it wild.
And the score is Edmonds.
When I'm kind of off balance when I throw, and it takes me out of the baseline. If you're rounding third base, you're probably going to run out into that direction.
And now taking a tumble is Rowland, and he's going to be called safe.
An interference is called because he impeded with the runner.
He interfered with him, didn't try, but he was definitely in the way of the runner.
Inge charged with not one but two errors.
If Rowland ran into me on purpose, I'm not sure of it. But if he did, you know, it's a smart play. I'm not going to hate the guy because of it. As a matter of fact, he's one of the players I respect just about more than anyone as a third baseman. Just one of those fluke plays.
The end result is two runs for the Cardinals and a 7-1 lead.
Reyes continued his mastery, at one point retiring 17 straight and 22 of 23.
1-2-3 for Detroit. Anthony Reyes and the Cardinals are cruising to the ninth inning.
And in the ninth, Reyes gave way to his bullpen to secure the series lead.
A swing and a drive into center field. Edmonds drifts to his left.
And the Cardinals. Cardinals have taken game one, 7-2.
And the Cardinals come in here behind their rookie Anthony Reyes and shock this big crowd.
They came in here with very little rest, and they clobber the Tigers, who had a week off.
No one's going to tell you that the layoff was the key factor, but the whole team was flat that day. When you're not competing every single day, you lose a little edge.
You know, everyone on our team is just trying to stay focused and realize that we got to win three more games and not get too excited about game one, but understand that it was important to pick up that win.
Good job, guys. Anthony Reyes with the game of his life.
I'm just going to take it as a win in the World Series and try to think about you know, what I've done when this whole thing's over with. But right now, we got the series win.
Manager Jim Leyland, but clearly the week off affected the Tigers, and we're looking for a very different performance in game two tonight.
The Tigers are looking at the next three games being played in St. Louis, and so they really must win tonight, or this World Series could be over very quickly.
The matchup tonight, the former Tiger Jeff Weaver.
Jeff Weaver, I like Jeff a lot. He's made it known. He's got a little axe to grind, and I think that's great.
Kenny Rogers has been incredible.
He's definitely a good pitcher, and he's been having a great postseason.
15 innings, and he has yet to allow an earned run.
I expect it to be a good game tonight, a good matchup.
Terrific matchup tonight.
Before 2006, Rogers had struggled mightily in postseason play, but now had seemingly conquered his playoff demons.
Every player has doubts about what they're capable of at certain given times, and I'm no different. But it's nice to know that if you're willing to go out there and take the chance and possibly fail again, if you're out there, you always have a chance to succeed.
One out, nobody on. Here's the pitch on the way. Fastball, strike three, caught in the inside corner.
Two on, two out, and a comeback to the Rogers.
But as Kenny pitched through the first inning, the television cameras focused on a mysterious dark stain in the palm of his hand.
What's on the base of the left thumb of Kenny Rogers?
We detected it. I informed some of MLB officials and alerted them to that. And we tried to take the appropriate measures in a very professional way.
And what was there in the opening frame was gone by the second. Meanwhile, back in the first inning, Jeff Weaver ran into problems of his own in the form of Craig Monroe.
I'm going to be aggressive. I'm looking first pitch fastball, and I'm going to let it go.
Here's a fly ball, left field, way back! Off the bat of Monroe! Gone! Tigers take a 1-0 lead in the first.
It seemed like it was in slow motion, and all of a sudden it was just like, do you know where you're at? This is a World Series, and you just hit a home run.
It was a pretty good shot. It kind of set a tone for us. He came back to the dugout pretty fired up.
Then with two out in the first, Maglio Ordonez set the table for one of the Tigers' most clutch postseason hitters.
Into left center field. Wilson back on the run at the track over his head. And Ordonez, all the way from first, makes it 2-0.
Detroit blew scoring opportunities in the next three innings, but come the fifth, Guillen once again showed why he's one of the game's best-kept secrets.
Nobody hears about this guy, but Carlos Guillen is the most underrated player.
He's one of those guys, man. If you get a chance to watch him every day, you really appreciate Carlos Guillen. You start to realize he's one of the best players in baseball, that kind of thing, you know?
Now here's Guillen, a smash, past Pujols, down the right field line, headed for the right field corner. Guillen digging for second. The ball finally picked up in the corner by Encarnacion. Guillen heading for third, a triple.
That was another big hit for us, just another big hit for Carlos Guillen and for us in the postseason. It was crucial for us with some missed opportunities to try and, you know, to get him in.
And the veteran Casey had no intention of leaving Guillen stranded on third.
Weaver ready from the stretch. He throws. Curveball, line drive, base hit to right field. Guillen comes in to score, and Sean Casey delivers in the clutch the two-out base hit, 3-0 Detroit.
Rogers continued his phenomenal postseason success by allowing just one Cardinal to get into scoring position.
When
he's been able to do has been unbelievable.
Waiting on the payoff pitch from Kenny Rogers. Swing and a miss. Got him on strikes.
It's an honor to watch. You know, one of the best postseason performances ever.
What a talent that he has to be able to be a good pitcher, but also help himself out by being a good fielder.
Change up away, speared by Kenny Rogers. A line drive, one of the best defensive pitchers of all time.
I want to be a good fielder because I know the benefits that come with that, and I get more satisfaction out of that than I do striking someone out by far.
Now the 2-2 pitch, swing and a miss, got him on strikes.
I know that he's given 100% of his soul to go out there and win for us.
Kenny Rogers has one hit the Cardinals through six.
Rogers would extend his streak of scoreless postseason innings this year to 23.
Fastball swung on and missed. He struck him out. Kenny Rogers, 7 shutout innings.
For a guy who's tasted no postseason success to do it back-to-back weekends in 2 big games is just been a really incredible thing to watch.
That man is absolutely driven.
He continues to be the master of the postseason.
When Rogers left after 8 shutout innings, the St. Louis batters were more than happy to see a new face heading to the mound.
Now Todd Jones will try and end it. Go, Todd!
But the Cards refused to go quietly. And after Rowland's 2-out hit, former Tiger Juan Encarnacion followed with a tapper that could have ended the game.
Play. Encarnacion is safe, and the tying run will step to the plate for the Cardinals.
When our club starts, our number one goal is to play a hard 9 innings.
2 down, runners at the corners.
The pitch to Jimmy Edmonds, the tying run. The runner goes, swinging a little fly ball down the left field line of his fair. It's trouble. It is fair. In to score is Rowland, and the tying run in scoring position on a double by Jimmy Edmonds.
Come hell or high water, we're going to play a hard 9 innings.
A base hit to the outfield could tie the game. Here's the pitch. High and tight, and it hit Preston Wilson.
As nervous as anything.
Bases loaded, 2 out.
The 1-0 pitch. Ground ball to short. This should do it. Santiago underhand flip for the force at second. And the Tigers have tied the series at a game apiece.
When the game is over 8, we played 9, they beat us, tip your cap.
It was the Tigers' first World Series victory since the clinching 5th game in 84, and the Fall Classic now moved to St. Louis, tied at 1 game apiece. New Busch Stadium was about to play host to its first World Series game. And thanks to a split in Detroit, the home team was feeling just fine.
Doing a little MLB World Series DVD thing.
You know it.
All right, let's go hang out a little bit.
It's amazing how life works, man. Look, what, how long you spent in the minor leagues?
8 years.
8 years in the minor leagues, dog. And now World Series.
Get your MLB World Series program here.
And we are moments away from getting started at the brand new Busch Stadium, the inaugural season for this beautiful new ballpark in downtown St. Louis. Over 40,000 people, the vast majority of them, as always, wearing Cardinal red.
Got the adrenaline pumped for the World Series.
In a red sea here in St. Louis this evening.
Definitely enjoy playing in front of our fans. You know, they're the greatest fans out there, and I think any team that comes here knows that this is a baseball city, and we love playing in front of them because they give us all the energy, and they're for us no matter what.
We got the Clydesdales tonight. 55 degrees.
This ain't bad, man. I thought it was going to be chillier. It's nice.
Clear skies, no rain in the forecast. We're going to have baseball tonight here in St. Louis.
Now it's tied 1-1, and we're coming home. We got Chris Carpenter, our ace. He goes out there with the pressure of being the number one guy.
They're going to take charge of the series here at home. Carpenter needs to win tonight.
He is the leader of our pitching staff, not only in performance, but in character.
Here we go.
He is also the reigning Cy Young Award winner and had 4 victories and 5 postseason decisions to his credit. But because of an arm injury in the 2004 season, this was Carpenter's first appearance in a World Series.
Having the opportunity to be there in 04 was amazing. Unfortunately, not being able to pitch was disappointing and frustrating. Having an opportunity to get back here is even more amazing.
The advantage would seem to be with the Cardinals tonight at home with Carpenter, his earned run average at home this year, the best in baseball.
Carpenter with a 1.81 earned run average at home, he loves pitching here in St. Louis.
He's a tremendous pitcher and a tremendous competitor, and obviously we'll have our hands full.
We're ready for game three. Carpenter is ready to go.
I know that I prepared myself physically, I prepared myself mentally, and I have to go out and execute.
Carpenter came right after.
He's blessed with special talent, and he knows how to use it.
They set him down 1, 2, 3, and what a great omen that is.
Carpenter had faced Detroit once before this year and allowed 7 earned runs. Not this time.
Curve ball struck him out swinging. That was a big sweeper.
I came into the game in game 3 with a great game plan.
If he drops him off like that
in the remainder of the game, it'll be all over, won't it?
Oh, school's wow. Out.
Trying to be aggressive, trying to work the count, trying to throw the first pitch strike with any pitch.
A lot of times it is not going to be a good pitch to hit, but, you know, it's easier said than done to lay off of that.
That day he has his good stuff, man. He has his curveball working and his cutter, his sinker.
Boy, that sinker down and in, cutter away. Talking about using both sides of the plate with power.
The fourth pitch inning for Carpenter.
I just knew that I was on. I knew that I had my stuff, and I just needed a couple runs to get through that game.
But runs were hard to come by, for Nate Robertson was just as tough through 3.
No runs, no hits for the Cardinals. They've had one base runner.
Then in the 4th, Nate's nemesis came to the plate in the person of Preston Wilson.
It's amazing how Wilson has hit against Robertson. He came in 5 for 5 with 2 home runs.
Wilson gets a base hit into left field to start the bottom of the 4th.
The Cardinals have not only their first hit of the night, but it's the first time they put their leadoff man on, and who's that been?
Chase the pitch and shoots it down the right field line. It'll be a ground rule double as it hops out of play. 2nd and 3rd, nobody out.
Another example of Pujols' ability to hit to all field.
They were going to go inside, and Robertson made a mistake away.
It's just remarkable how much of the plate he could cover.
Because this is one of those innings that's starting badly for Robertson, and the Cardinals are starting to smell a big inning here. He walks Bologna on 4 pitches, and the bases are loaded with nobody out.
Then with 1 out, a most professional hitter came to the plate.
1 down, base is still loaded for Jim Edmonds.
Still no score.
Nate Robertson was pitching. He's moving the ball around and had pretty good velocity that night. And being lefty-lefty right there, that's a tough situation.
Nate Robertson has chewed up left-handers all year. Edmonds, the only left-hander in the Cardinal lineup.
I was kind of hoping he would just leave a ball out over the plate that I could hit a fly ball into left center field and get 1 run.
A swing and a shot, fair! It's inside the first base bag and down the right field line.
Jimmy came up in a big situation, but I've seen him do it so many times.
Pujols scores, here comes Roland.
He's a big time guy, and on a big time stage, he definitely delivers.
He's really focused and concentrating every at bat and tried to contribute to help our team out to win, and that's what he has done so far.
And the Cardinals have a 2-0 lead on the 2 base hit by Jim Edmonds.
The way Carpenter was pitching, it was just a huge push forward for us.
Chris never came close to walking a hitter and had the Tigers swinging at air.
He's got every pitch working. He's did a great job of getting ahead 0-1 a majority of the game.
Not gone to a 3-ball count on the Tigers batter tonight.
The reason why I didn't go to 3-ball count is because they didn't allow me to go to 3-ball count. I was attacking the strike zone with the ball down, and they were very aggressive.
And when the Tigers did make contact, the St. Louis defense made sure to pick their ace up.
And a line drive caught by Pujols at first. Here comes Taguchi on the run, on the run, on the run. He slides and makes the catch.
1, 2, 3 go the Tigers in the 7th.
Robertson left trailing just 2-0, but hard-throwing Joel Zumaia was wild everywhere he threw.
Outside, back-to-back walks ahead of Pujols. This could be big trouble for Detroit.
We had 1st and 2nd, Albert up, and Albert hits it right back to the mound.
He throws to 3rd, he throws it wildly.
He made a mistake. He should go to second base in that play. He maybe had a double play out it.
Tigers' best defense has not been on display in the first three games of the World Series.
And it's 4-0 Cardinals here in the seventh.
Every run so critical with the way Chris Carpenter is going, and the Tigers just gave the Cardinals two runs.
With a four-run lead, Carpenter returned for the eighth and was once again lights out.
Electric stuff with electric command. That's a tough combination for a hitter.
That is total domination. Anytime you go 80 pitches in 8 innings in a playoff game against a World Series team, that means that you were never behind in the count, and they didn't get many people on base.
Carpenter, 8 innings, no runs, 3 hits, no walks, 6 strikeouts.
Carpenter was done by the 9th inning, but then so were the Tigers.
The Cardinals win the ball game 5-0. St. Louis takes a 2-1 series lead in this October Classic.
And this team can live with getting beat in Game 3 by Chris Carpenter, because he turned in one of the greatest World Series games in a long time.
You can talk about the week off. You can talk about the day off yesterday. You can talk about the cold weather. But, hey, no excuses. Carpenter's just pitched a whale of a ball game.
To do it to a Tigers lineup who's hungry and in the World Series, that's what big pitchers do. Carpenter did it for us in Game 3.
We got the real Chris Carpenter here tonight.
What Chris did in Game 3 helped us keep that momentum and set up the next 2 days.
For baseball tonight, Game 4 of the World Series. This crowd is packed Busch Stadium after sitting through a long rain delay last night. You can just tell there's a little pent-up energy in this crowd tonight getting ready for Game 4.
I'm tired of looking at radar screens. It's time to play baseball.
A lot of focus paid to the Tiger hitters who are hitless so far in this series.
Just stay loose. You're too good. You know that.
Right now in the lineup, we have 3 guys that are 0 for 34, the combination. So basically the key is to get them going.
So Leland shook up the lineup, a move made more for inspiration than out of desperation.
The series is only 2-1. The point of no return is when you lose 4. But when it's 2-1, it's hardly a time to panic. We're certainly not going to panic. We're going to play as hard as we can. We're going to hopefully try to even it up tonight.
This is a big ball game tonight. If they lose tonight, they'll be down 3-1. And then every game will be a have-to-win game from here on.
There's no magic what they have to do. They have to be very focused here tonight, get off to a good start.
4.
Here we go.
Jeremy Bonderman will get the start for the Tigers tonight. Jeff Suppan, who's been nearly unhittable his last 2 starts in the postseason, he'll get the start for St. Louis.
There were those who thought the rainout and the 24-hour wait might take its toll on Suppan. His skipper was not one of them.
I don't know that you'd meet another pitcher that's better at handling that type of disruption than Jeff Suppan.
Sean Casey was another matter, for he did disrupt the pitcher and dealt the game's first blow in the top of the 2nd inning.
Now the 1-0 pitch to Sean Casey. Fly ball, right field, it's deep. Going back is the right fielder, Duncan, at the fence. He leaps, and that ball is gone, a home run. Sean Casey gets the Tigers on the board early with a home run into the Cardinals' bullpen. 1-0 Tigers in the second.
I was going to come in at his hands, and I pulled it right down to exactly where I did not want to throw it. Basically, it was the right pitch, but the wrong location.
Jeff faced more trouble 1 inning later with 2 on and Casey once again at the bat.
Line drive, base hit, down the right field line. Hustling over is Duncan to cut it off in the corner. Coming around third is Granderson. He'll score. Heading around third is Guillen, and now he's going to be held up by Lamont. Sean Casey with a clutch RBI single, and the Tigers have a 2-0 lead.
It looked like Casey was looking for the breaking ball. He got it and drives in his 2nd run of the ball game. Good hitting by Casey.
And good hitting proved to be contagious.
Come on, punch! Base hit into right field.
He in into score, stopping at 2nd is Casey, and the Tigers lead 3-0. Rodriguez delivers.
That's a bat that has been missing from the Tiger lineup until tonight.
Two for two night after an 0 for 23. And to get Pudge Rodriguez's bat going, how big is that?
The Tigers had given Jeremy Bonderman a 3-0 lead, but in the bottom of the third, Eckstein was in the midst of a very big night.
We were down 3-0 and had the runner on second, so I was definitely going to try and be aggressive and try to swing at a good pitch.
A swing, and there's a ball hit to left center. That gets down and rolls past Monroe. Miles scores. Eckstein has an RBI double. The Cardinals trail by two.
And that's a really big run because Bonderman was cruising pretty much. And what happens is if you score on a guy, now he knows that you can hurt him. And that makes a big difference in this ballgame. Swing, line drive, clear. Pass the diving engine down the left field line into the corner. Roman comes in to score as Molina heads into second with a stand-up double.
Players go through cycles, and I think Yachty hit a good cycle at the right time. He really fell into a nice, comfortable stretch as soon as the playoffs started, and it's been huge for us.
Another big hit for Yadier Molina.
And now it's a one-run lead for the Tigers, 3-2. And the Cardinals obviously are right back in this ballgame.
Bonderman held on to that lead into the sixth when he put two men on with one out. His manager had seen enough.
Well, here comes Jim Leland out of the dugout, and he has signaled to the bullpen already.
Fernando Rodney is coming out of the Tigers' bullpen.
Now Bonderman has to turn himself from being an upset starting pitcher yanked out of the game to a cheerleader.
Runners at the corners, one out, 3-2 Tigers lead in the bottom of the sixth inning. Swing and a miss. He got him on strikes. What a big strikeout for Fernando Rodney. Runners at the corners and two outs now.
Yeah, I thought that was the inning that we were going to break through. You know, we were going to score a bunch of runs.
A 1-2. What a job by Fernando Rodney.
Fernando Rodney, he's just a great pitcher. You know, he made a couple of good pitches, strike those guys out.
He strikes out Miles and Rodriguez and strands two. And the Tigers still have the lead after six.
Rodney had snuffed out the Cardinals' quest for a big inning. But in baseball, disaster is just one slip away.
Fly ball to center field. Granderson's on the run. He falls down. He falls down and the ball goes over his head. Eckstein is safe at second. There's a break for the Cardinals.
This field took a lot of rain last night and today, and it plays tricks on Curtis Granderson.
I thought when it was hit, you know what I mean, Granderson was going to catch it, but unfortunately the field was so slick and wet, he slipped, so able to get a double off of that.
There's nothing you can do about it. You've done everything right, but the ground gives out from under you. You feel bad knowing how that feels and knowing that he had to go through that, but it's part of the game.
Once again, Detroit's suspect defense had created a problem, and once again, their pitcher would make it worse.
Here is Taguchi showing bunt, and he pushes it up the first base side. That's going to work. Off the mound again, it is Rodney. He picks up the wet baseball and throws it down the right field line. Here comes Eckstein, and the game is tied up.
He bunts the ball. You know, you're like, okay, yeah, good bunt.
I take a look back to see once he threw the ball. I was like, uh-oh.
And then the next thing you know, he just kind of shot puts it, and you just see the ball squirt away.
That is the fourth error by Detroit Tigers pitchers. Most by a pitching staff on one team in a World Series.
This is absolutely crazy.
So when the ball went awry, you know, make sure I touch third base and be able to get home.
And it's almost like slow motion. Everybody's hitting the dugouts like, the ball ends up down the line. It was just one of those moments that you're not going to forget.
The game was now tied, but the Cardinals weren't through.
Hit, base hit. Here comes Taguchi. The throw by Monroe to the plate cut off. The Cardinals lead.
I faced Rodney before, and he's made me look really silly on that changeup sometimes. And he threw a changeup that stayed up, didn't get as much action as it normally does, and I hit a line drive through the hole.
Preston Wilson comes through in the clutch with another two-out RBI hit.
Postseason baseball, it has been like that for years. Usually when there's a mistake, the other team capitalizes on it, and I think just because the stakes are so much higher.
And the Cardinals have gone ahead. A disastrous inning for the Detroit Tigers.
Down 4-3 with six outs to go, the Tigers clawed back. putting the tying run in scoring position. And that spurred La Russa to call on his rookie closer.
Adam Wainwright is coming on. Tying run at third, one out. Inch coming up for the Tigers.
Coming in that situation, I have a runner on third base and one out. I'm trying to get Inge out without the runner scoring.
That was the plan. But since when does baseball follow a plan?
That one is way back there and over the head of Edmonds, up against the wall. Coming in to score is Rodriguez. Into second with a double is Brandon Inge. It's 4-4 in the eighth.
Once he hit the double and the run scored to tie it, I just said, you know what, I got to keep him right here. They cannot score again.
The 3-2 pitch. Strike! Three call down the middle.
He was able to settle right back down, get under control, and get the next two outs without letting them score, and that was huge for us.
With the game now tied at four, the Cardinals got a spark from who else? Their spark plug.
Mr. 5'7", 165 pounds, David Eckstein.
He's the little fellow on this team. I mean, he's just cute as could be, but he's gritty.
It was a classic showdown. The diminutive David against the imposing pitching Goliath.
Facing Zamaya, I got the opportunity to face him the last game we played, so I had a little bit of a read on him and just trying to get my timing against him.
The dangerous Eckstein at the plate.
Just fortunate enough, I was able to get the barrel of the bat onto the ball, and it barely found a hole.
The pitch, swing, fly ball left center field. Monroe on the move to his left. Dives! And it's off the edge of the zone. It rolls away. Coming around third to score, the go-ahead run is Miles. And into second is Eckstein. It's 5-4. The Cardinals are back ahead.
I told you they were cheating in too much. And that cheating in by the outfielders cost him. He got his glove on it, but it went off the webbing. And David Eckstein made them pay.
This is a game of inches. Monroe makes an unbelievable attempt diving in left field, and he came up an inch short.
For the second time tonight, Eckstein comes through with two down and a clutch RBI hit.
Two out hits are big hits. When you're up there, you know you have the whole team that's counting on you, and you definitely want to perform.
What a night for David Eckstein.
David just did a great job getting on base for us and getting those two big hits with two outs at the right time.
And that's one of the reasons why we love him, because when he's on your team, you love him, but on that other side, he's like the pest that you cannot get out of the house. No matter how many times you swat him, he keeps getting up. You can't beat him down.
Eckstein had given St. Louis the lead, and Wainwright ensured the pivotal victory in the ninth.
The Cardinals have won again. Clutch hitting turns into a win for the Cardinals. Eckstein in the third, Molina in the fourth, Wilson in the seventh, Eckstein again in the eighth. All had two out RBI hits in a 5-4 Cardinals win.
Frame of mind on the club is outstanding. Our responsibility is to take care of the Cardinal business.
And now they are one win away from winning the World Series.
We know the Tigers will be ready to play. We'll be ready to play, and then you play the game.
We have to win three games. Are we capable of doing that? Absolutely. Are we in a good position? Absolutely not. We win, we keep playing. If we don't, we go home.
Despite their commanding lead, the Cardinals weren't about to take anything for granted.
We got a two-game lead right now, but it's not over. We need to step out there and just play nine innings hard and just find a way to win this game tonight.
For the Cardinals, nobody thought they would be in this position this early.
You play one game to win a series.
Coming from out of nowhere, to be in this situation now.
A chance to win their first championship in 24 years.
If we can deliver that here, that'd be great.
Big, big crowd, and they are all jittered up here tonight. They want to see a world championship flag fly over downtown St. Louis.
For the Cardinals, it will be the former Tigers. Jeff Weaver, who has been a revelation in this postseason.
There was a very determined look on Jeff's face. He had come to the ballpark that day ready to pitch and ready to do whatever it took for him to win the game.
It started with just warming up. I wanted to make sure to slow things down,
try to trick myself into acting like it was a normal, everyday game.
It was cold and took a little while to get loose, but he had a normal warm-up. There was nothing different about it.
You know, dunking over your shoulder, just watching you. You know, he's kind of the quiet assassin. He just kind of sits there. When he doesn't say something, that's a good thing. And no words were spoken in the bullpen before game five.
A virtual cast-off earlier this year. The Cardinals traded for Weaver in July, hoping he could plug a hole. Remarkably, he'd finished with the lowest ERA of all St. Louis postseason starters.
He came in from the bullpen. You could see it in his eyes. He was just locked in. You could see there was no nerves, no nothing. He was going to go out and give his best effort.
One ball, two strike delivery. Swing and a miss. He threw a four-seamer right by him. Swing and a miss. He struck him out.
Another breaking ball.
Weaver spun an artful web through the first three innings, but his counterpart, Justin Verlander, was not so precise. He threw a scoreless 35-pitch first inning, but then the Cardinals continued their trend of pouncing on Tiger mistakes.
Eckstein shatters his bat. That's a fair ball. Hicks throws wildly to first. Cardinals take the lead, and Eckstein has delivered again.
But that slim lead didn't last long, as Duncan's error gave Detroit life.
And now we'll see if the Tigers can take advantage of that mistake by St. Louis. And who better for Detroit to step in right now than their hottest hitter, Sean Casey.
Casey swings and hits a drive, deep right field, down the line, and it is out of here for a two-run homer. And just like that, the Tigers jump in front, 2-1.
But the Cardinals kept their cool.
I think that we knew as long as we could stay close with our crowd and the way our momentum was going that we could get a run here and a run there, and we just needed to get it started.
And they did just that, putting two men on with nobody out. What happened next had happened before.
He squares around, bunts it back toward the mound. Verlander off the mound to get it, turns, throws over to third. He throws wildly. Another Tigers pitching error. Coming around third to score the tying run is Molina. Can you believe that?
The ball was hit to his right side. He turns that way, and right away he thought about third base, but he should have more time and throw to second base and maybe had a double play.
And on a play where the Cardinals are giving them an out, the Tigers get none.
I was actually found out later that I wasn't supposed to be bunting, so it was actually a missed sign.
Not a hard play, but you could almost see the wheels in his head turning as he threw to third base.
It was unbelievable. I mean, each and every game, it was a fielding play that resulted in us scoring some runs, and that's what you have to do is take advantage of those mistakes.
And after the error, Eckstein is the batter.
When you're playing these tough games, it definitely comes down to the execution of the game.
He was 0 for 11 to start the World Series. Since then, David is 7 for his last 9. Eckstein swings and hits it hard to the shortstop, and the play will be at first. The run will score. Eckstein gets an RBI. The Cardinals lead 3-2.
I mean, just an incredible turnaround. A ball bunted right back to Verlander, and it turns into a disaster.
That is what usually wins the ball games, is who can execute and perform in the crucial situation.
And to have something like that happen, it just kind of refreshes you and gets you back to where you need to be.
Team scores, your pitcher goes out there. Can you shut him down? It's a real pressure type inning for the pitcher because the shutdown, you get back in the dugout, maybe you add runs and game's over.
Once we got that lead again, I was total focused to keep putting up zeros, and you're just like, this is it.
Drops down from the side, the breaking ball strikes him out swinging.
What he did in the fifth gave us a big jolt.
Weaver has turned in a beauty up to this point.
And what little trouble he did encounter was whisked away with strikes.
Swing and a miss, he struck him out.
The Cardinals also continued to play outstanding defense.
Here's a swing and a ball hit. Pujols, a diving stop. He rolls, throws to Weaver. Weaver picks it, and he got him at first. Sensational!
St. Louis added another run in the seventh, but the story of this game was the man on the mound.
You cannot give Jeff Weaver enough credit for his turnaround this year.
What a
an incredible season for Jeff Weaver. His most forgettable season in the major leagues, perhaps. And it's been salvaged by an incredibly good postseason.
We wouldn't be where we are without Jeff Weaver. Jeff had taken his lumps from so many spots all season. And to bounce back from that and then to compete at the highest level against his former team.
Slider, strike three call. Jeff Weaver is pitching the game of his life.
That's unbelievable metal and steel that he had and just guts. And to be that clutch for us, it was so fun watching him enjoy that moment.
Weaver's pitch. Swing and a miss. He struck him out.
I was just kind of looking up in the crowd as I was walking off, just kind of soaking it in for a second on the slow walk back, knowing that we were three outs away from winning a championship. It was just surreal, and you know, it seemed like 2 million towels were swinging around, and I got into the dugout and started shaking hands with the guys. It was just a dream come true.
Adam Wainwright, the 25-year-old rookie closer, in to try and end the World Series.
Every teammate is looking at him and saying, Adam, get three outs and make us a world champion. Think about that. What a burden that is, the responsibility. You have got to be so tough. So sure enough, threw a couple pitches down, a couple pitches up.
Wainwright throws just off the outside.
You see him breathe.
The Tigers tightened the knot by putting the tying runs on base. But Wainwright never wavered.
The weirdest thing for me is I got the best view in the house, and that's all a blur.
I'm standing out there in left field, and I see Adam on the mound, and Inge steps up to the plate.
Brandon Inge, 6 hits in 16 at-bats in the World Series, 0-2 the count.
You know, he gets strike one and strike two there, and all you're thinking is just one pitch. We just need to make one more pitch.
No matter how it was, he comes up huge in big situations, and I knew he was going to do it again.
Wainwright has the sign he wants. He brings it home. In. Swing and a miss. The Cardinals were world champions for 2006.
For the first time since 1982, St. Louis has a World Series winner.
I can't describe the elation, the relief. But what you're feeling more than anything else is so many guys in this club are going to get their first ring.
It was the first World Series championship in St. Louis in a generation. A reason to celebrate.
And the celebration begins. The St. Louis Cardinals are the champions of the baseball world.
All of a sudden, it's like we're doing what I've watched other teams do for years.
To rush in and see the flashbulbs going, the confetti, and to celebrate with your teammates, it's perfect.
It's hard to explain, but the emotions and joys that just come pouring out are unbelievable.
Like Jeff Weaver, the game that he pitched after the year that he had, going through the adversity that he went through, just seeing the tears in his eyes.
Just a surreal situation. Just turning and seeing the joy on everyone's face was unbelievable.
It was a great moment of my life, you know. It was a great moment.
To win a world championship, but to win it at home. So you get that celebration where the fans who have helped you with their adrenaline over the course of the season, for them to share with you, it's just, wow.
The St. Louis Cardinals are the world champions.
Even those who stood in its midst felt like they were caught up in a dream.
I couldn't believe it. We did it. There was a stage, you'd look around, the fans are going nuts.
They had waited almost a quarter of a century for this moment, and they made sure to soak it all in.
You know, I think the fans will appreciate it. I think they deserve that because they've been supporting us for years.
It's always important to thank them because they are with you the whole year, and it comes down to just your appreciation for them.
I just want to thank the fans for their tremendous support because without it, this wouldn't be possible. You all are the best in baseball.
The fan base goes from generation to generation, and what's made the Cardinals great is that we now have 10 world championships, 17 National League pennants.
The St. Louis Cardinals are world champions.
This reinforces the current generation's love of the team.
Thank you.
And it was only fitting that Eckstein became the first National League shortstop to be named the series MVP.
All fans have probably heard a lot about how tough and gritty he is, but they had a chance to see how talented he is.
David, you had a great series, drove in big runs. Congratulations. You've played the game the way it's supposed to be played.
You love trying to prove people that anything's accomplishable if you just have heart and you go out there and you give your best.
I just thank everybody. I thank the fans. You guys were unbelievable coming behind us, supporting us. And we got ourselves this championship.
And one day later, that title was celebrated by many thousands of passionate fans at the championship parade.
Here we go.
It's unreal, unbelievable. In your wildest dreams, you never could come up with this. I can't believe just how many people have showed up.
There were some areas where people were 20, 30 people deep, just standing along the side of the road, sitting in trees, on top of buildings.
I think there's a lot more than 40,000 people here.
It was louder than a rock concert. It was better than anything you could ever go to. It was crazy to think that that many people took their time out of their day just to come down and cheer.
The party continued at the new Busch Stadium, owner of a title in just its first year, where the Cardinals saluted
the greatest baseball fans in the world. Welcome to Busch Stadium, the home of your 2006 world champion St. Louis Cardinals.
From all of us, thank you. I think we've all shared a dream, and we can officially say that when we got that last out in Game 5, our world championship dream came true. Let's enjoy it.
Ladies and gentlemen, your 2006 world champion St. Louis Cardinals.
Unbelievable, look at this. Who would have thought, huh?
As improbable as it seemed at the end of the regular season, the Cardinals were World Series champions. Others may have forgotten what it means to be a Cardinal, but they never did.
Some said that the Cardinals, before this series began, were the worst team ever to play in the World Series.
I know a lot of people were saying that we don't deserve to be here because we were 83 games, and there were kind of guys that were really mad because we work hard for this.
What do you say to them?
What about now? Don't now.
If you look back a week before the season was over, you would never believe that the Cardinals would be here celebrating a world championship.
There's so many emotions that are involved in with just having such a rough season, having so many different types of players, new guys, young guys, guys that have been released, guys that we traded for.
What could you possibly say to those people that thought you guys didn't have a chance?
That's all I gotta say.
I think what we went through the season gave us the strength to carry through the postseason.
We've faced a lot of adversity this year.
The Cardinals haven't won a game in a week.
We've battled through a lot of injuries.
And Edmonds is hurt.
We've had three horribly bad losing streaks during the year.
The Cardinals almost blew a seven-game lead down the stretch.
And our fans have stuck beside us.
But right now, that all seems like a distant memory.
If the right team is clicking with the right guys, you can beat anybody.
The message is like, all you have to do is play better than the other team. If your team executes better than they, you will win. And we executed better than the three teams we played against, so we're the winners.
They persevered, they played hard, and the one thing about the Cardinals, they just never quit fighting every game they played in this year.
I think that the best thing about this World Series is you sit back and watch the highlights. You don't see too many guys in more than one highlight, and that's kind of the team we had. Everybody did something, and that's pretty impressive.
And now these Cardinals can stand toe-to-toe with the legendary champions of the past.
And now you feel like you can walk up and look right at Stan and Red and Bob and Lou. Hey, man, we did it too, see? It's unbelievable.